It's the final home game for Stephon LaFours and the highest-ranked senior class in school history. They want to go out in championship style here in Louisville, where the race to a conference title ends today. The number 8 ranked Cardinals host Red Hot Cincinnati next. And on a windy, chilly day, welcome to a sold-out Papa John's Cardinal Stadium in Louisville, part of our Thanksgiving weekend on ESPN2. Winners of 4 straight, the Cincinnati Bearcats visiting the number 8-1 Cardinals of Louisville. Welcome, Dave Barnett, along with Bill Curry, David Norrie. And if you have not had a chance to treat yourself yet this year to this Cardinal offense, Bill, there really is none like them in the country.
It is unique. It is simply the leading offense in the nation, 543 yards a game, featuring uncanny accuracy by the quarterbacks, misdirection and mobility. I swear, if you had generic uniforms on them, David, you'd think you were watching Steve Young and the great 49er offenses. It is really fun unless you have to stop it.
Well, Stephon LaFours hitting 75% of his passes, but across the field, the leader for Cincinnati, Gino Gaduli, he has a broken hand, a broken throwing hand. That's the big question mark, the key to the game. He's been red hot in his 4-game win streak for Cincinnati. He's hitting over 70% of his balls during the win streak, 12 touchdowns, no interceptions. It's going to be interesting, Bill and Dave, to see if he's able to go this afternoon for Cincinnati.
And for more, we welcome the fourth member of our crew on the sidelines, Heather Cox.
Well, I think the hardest working people all week long has been Cincinnati's medical staff. What they did is actually call Trevor Burris up with the Green Bay Packers to ask how they dealt with Brett Favre's broken thumb. They brainstormed, came up with 3 solutions to get Geno on the field to play. One of them is this glove. They actually cut out the pad so that Geno could feel the ball. The second option is this glove with actually a harder orthocast support and padding to protect the hand. The third option, the one that they'll use, is using this orthoclast. They heat it up, they melt it to his hand, and he has tape on top of it. Nobody knows if Geno's going to go. If he doesn't, Collins will get the number 2. He's been the backup all season long. But also, guys, George Murray, the top receiver for Cincinnati, took reps at quarterback position during warmups. We'll see who's out there.
Gino Gaduli has not missed a practice in his entire Bearcat career until this week. So the bitter irony, inescapable. He injured himself leaving his house last Saturday night, slipped on his porch, and as he tried to brace his fall, he broke a bone on the top of his right or throwing hand. He came out immediately, said he expected to start. We'll see if his coach, Mark D'Antonio, saw enough of him in warm-ups to agree. And it is chilly, windy, and it might be rainy once we're all finished here this afternoon, with a 20-mile-an-hour breeze out of the south-southeast, and the forecast is for rain. 50 degrees, it feels quite a bit cooler than that. On the artificial surface here at Papa John's Cardinal Stadium, Mark D'Antonio, first year head coach of the Bearcats, defensive coordinator of Ohio State the last 3 years. And the 2 of those years, he had the number 3 and number 2 ranked run defense in the country. That his specialty coming in. Meanwhile, one of the hottest coaching names in the country has become Bobby Petrino. In just 2 years here at Louisville, 17 wins against just 5 losses, 10 school records, 6 Conference USA records in his first season, and he's picked up where that left off this year. In half of his 22 games as head coach, the Cardinals have scored 40 or more points. They average right at 40 points. They put on a show unlike any other offense in the country. 543 total yards, number 1 in the nation, 47.6 points, number 2 in the nation, trailing only Boise State. And Louisville has won the toss, and they want that offense on the field. When you see those numbers, you understand why they don't mess with deferring until the second half. Cincinnati will kick with the wind at their back, about 20 miles an hour plus, as Gino Gaduli came out and did not take the normal number of warm-up throws today. He has not had a single warm-up pass or practice pass, David, all week.
No, and playing quarterback in these conditions, 50 degrees with some stiff wind and the temperature falling, it's tough enough with a healthy right hand to throw the football. It's going to be a real challenge, and I think it's a 50-50 whether he's going to be able to go today, and even tougher odds in terms of being effective at quarterback in this kind of weather.
You never played a game in this kind of weather, did you? You just every went down now, there to UCLA.
Every now and then we'd have to visit Seattle.
Yeah, that doesn't look good. That was during warm-ups. We were down there, and Cincinnati very excited. The team really making a lot of gestures about the fact that they're emotionally prepared, rushing at the Louisville team in the warm-ups.
Kevin Lovell lays into it, and Harry Douglas thinking better of his initial feeling that might be a returnable ball. Certainly not. And the Bud Light starting lineups begin with Stephon LaForce with a chance to set the single season all-time record NCAA history for completion percentage and for passing rating this year, threatening Dante Culpepper's 73.6% at Central Florida his senior year, and Sean King's 183.3 rating that same season at Tulane. They open in the eye. You'll see a number of looks. And an almost unstoppable passing game. They start with the run, and Eric Shelton breaks it untouched. 80 yards. Can run the ball too.
So much for emotional gesturing before the game and posturing. Cincinnati rushing to the football before the kickoff, rushing at the Louisville team during warm-ups. I always have wondered about that sort of thing, and Shelton just gave him a nice answer for Louisville.
Longest run of the year by the Cardinals, 17th touchdown of the year for Shelton, and Art Carmody adds the extra point. 247-pound junior out of Lexington with the first play from scrimmage. He barely got touched at the line in the last 70 yards, David, all his.
Yeah, that was a walk in the park for Shelton, and Shelton's a big bruising back. Not many moves. You're not going to see a lot of moves from Shelton. Not a lot of shake in the hole, but he has surprising speed, Bill, when he gets into the open field.
He does, and one of the star defensive ends, Andre Frazier, an undersized player out there playing up front at a body weight of 225, shows the fact that he's just not strong enough to get the 250-pound Shelton on the ground.
So how can you not be even more shell-shocked if you're Cincinnati, wondering if your senior quarterback can go, and before you can even get a quarterback on the field, you're down 7-0 in 11 seconds.
Well, I was standing here wondering, what does Louisville do when they have to go into the teeth of a stiff wind like this? And we found out. Just hand it to the big fella. He can run into the wind.
Gino Gadulli not wearing a helmet, and that's not a good sign for Cincinnati fans. It looks like we're going to see Colin Carey, the senior, who hasn't completed a pass, only one attempt on the season, four attempts in his career at Cincinnati. You talk about a baptism by fire.
The return by the Bearcats will end at the 20-yard line. And it will be Colin Carey, the senior, who has thrown one pass this year. Transfer from Eastern Michigan, where he threw only 10 passes in his entire career. He is 7 of 14 for 40 yards, and this is a senior we're talking about. With the Bearcats, 1 for 4 for 7 yards. That was last year. So Gadulli does not get the start, which means you have to wonder if you'll see him at all today. They start with a gun, and they give to Richard Hall, who is swarmed for a loss. He starts today 112 yards away from 1,000. The Bud Light starters for the Bearcats. Halls with a chance today to become the 13th Bearcat to rush for 1,000. Thomas 90 yards away from becoming their 4,000-yard receiver. Up front, five fifth-year seniors. Four returning starters make this the most experienced group in the country and probably the healthiest. They have started all season, every game, together as a unit.
Personal foul call against Louisville. Dead ball foul after that first down play by Cincinnati.
Fired up for this keg of nails. And a first down from the 38. Under center. Carry with the eye. And Hannibal Thomas, their top receiver, in motion. And again, Hall. Trying the middle without much there. Maybe a yard. Louisville's defense, top group in Conference USA. Overall, total, and against the run. Marcus Jones, 8 sacks, 2 last week against Houston. Linebackers led by Robert McCune, who ran an NFL time, 4-4 in the 40. They're leading tacklers 2 years running. And in the secondary, 3 seniors led by Kerry Rhodes. Defensive coordinator Mike Cassidy says he is as good as any of the 22 players Cassidy has coached who went on to the NFL. Right through the hands of Ernest Jackson, who was open at midfield. True freshman from Southfield, Michigan. And it'll bring up 3rd and 9.
Yeah, really a tough task. Colin Carey getting his first career start. You open up the game down 7 points. Louisville, I'm sure, going to the bit of a change in their strategy here defensively. They're going to load up a bit against the run. You don't have the pass threat, Bill, that you have with Gino Gadulli in the football game.
That's right. And Louisville's already stemming, moving their front to confuse the inexperienced quarterback.
Bearcats with the 1-back, 3-wide set and the play fake. Runs out of time and room. Sacked at the 34-yard line. Elvis Dumerville, junior defensive end out of Miami, with his 5th sack of the year.
This is what you're going to see with an inexperienced quarterback. Carey just taking his time, a little uncertain about pulling the trigger, and he holds it just a little too long. Wow, somebody got drilled in the back of the leg there. One of the old linemen, fortunately okay.
Chet Irvin will kick with the wind at his back. Every time he gets to today, he needs to take advantage, and not much height on this one. This is going to tumble down to the 24. Montrell Jones with only about 4 yards on the return of a 42-yard punt. 12:51 in the first quarter. Shelton scores 80 yards on the first play from scrimmage to make it 7-0 Cardinals.
ESPN2's College Football Saturday, brought to you by Wendy's Wild Mountain Chicken and Bacon Cheeseburger. It's better here. Yamaha, makers of fine motorcycles and ATVs. Nobody's more in tune with motorsports than Yamaha. And Wrangler, makers of Wrangler.
LaFour's to the air, and the catch is made by Joshua Tinch, his 33rd of the year, the Cardinals' second leading receiver. Let's check in with Heather down below.
Dave, all week long, the issue for Gino Gadulli was actually managing the swelling, not the pain. But as you'll recall, he did not make a throw all week long. The first time he threw a football was this morning at the hotel. They gave him a Nerf ball. Once he could do that, they actually gave him a football. He decided he was okay to go in at warm-ups, but once he decided to start throwing, there was way too much pain. We will not see Gino Gadulli for the rest of the day.
Play fake and another completion. This is a first down, and out of bounds around the 45-yard line is the tight end, freshman Gary Barnage. And we finally have a chance to check the Bud Light starters for the Louisville offense. Number one of the country, LaFour's topped at his spot, and Russell leads Conference USA, 6 catches per game. 4 Louisville receivers average a lot of yards per catch. And up front, the only senior center, Will Rabatine, he departs. This is his final home game. Plenty coming back, and Michael Bush, nearing 500 yards, the 3rd running back listed. Cincinnati defense, D the ends, Frazier and Cole, may both be in the NFL next year. They are in the top five all-time in Bearcat history for sacks in their career. The linebackers, Hackler, the leading tackler, 71 on the year, Enzor not far behind him. And in the secondary, there are three seniors, strong safety Monahan, in the top 10 all-time for tackles and interceptions. And these corners will live dangerously today. They want to go man-on-man all afternoon if they can. A flag down as J.R. Russell makes the catch and goes out of the 43. Conference USA referee today, Ed Ardito.
Offsetting fouls. Number 78 on the offense with a hold. Personal foul, roughing the passer, number 90 on the defense. Those penalties offset. Replay second down.
Travis LeFou for Louisville and Trent Cole for Cincinnati penalized.
Stephon LeFou's getting a bit of a rude welcome here late in the pocket. Luckily for Cincinnati, the holding call makes it offsetting penalties. But you're right, Dave, the man-to-man play on the corners outside, really a gamble by Cincinnati with the athletes that Louisville has at wide receiver today.
They have no doubts that they can survive man on man. Shelton on the carry, and an update from the studio. Welcome, Matt Weiner.
Thank you, David. Syracuse cruising toward halftime with a 21-point lead, but Brendan Carney blocks the punt, the perfect bounce to DeJuan Tribble, strolls into the end zone, and the Cues up 14 at halftime.
And Boston College playing for that automatic Big East BCS berth, maybe in Tempe for the Fiesta. Well, this is one year where it would look a whole lot better if Conference USA was represented in the BCS. Because if Louisville prevails here and next week against Tulane, and they are 10-1, how deserving a team would they be? That for Russell caught out of bounds, and the fans want to know if perhaps Davin Holley interfered, but no flag.
Well, Davin Holley chucked him, which was legal. This is not the NFL. You can do it beyond 5 yards. And when he did, he bumped him out of bounds. So he steps out of bounds just before the ball arrives. A very good call. I flew in with Ed Ardito, the referee, yesterday. He said, you'd be good to us. I said, I'm always good to you guys. All you got to do is make the right call. That was a very, very close call and a good one.
Second down and 10.
See, Bobby Petrino agrees.
Yeah. 46 of the Bearcats. And LeFour's keeping all the way. Where will they mark him out? At the 39. And it'll be third and 3. Well, they don't adjust it year by year, but if they have that ability in this BCS system, no doubt Louisville, a much better candidate than whoever comes out of the Big East to get one of those BCS top four bowl bids.
Now, there's a lot of critics of the BCS across the country that don't feel that a team like Boston College belongs in that grouping of eight teams, and I'm one of them.
Well, from their standpoint, they're trying to do what the rule said they had to do, win their conference. That was a different Big East, though, when those rules were set up. Eric Shelton with the 80-yard touchdown run to his credit already. Nail for a loss. Adam Roberts, junior defensive tackle, knifing in.
Talking to Mark D'Antonio, the fine young head coach for Cincinnati, during warm-ups, I said, you're going to have to take some more chances and get in the backfield and cause some lost yardage plays. And he said, absolutely. Nice job by Adam Roberts there.
Into the win now. Brent Moody gets the roll, and it goes right past the man waiting to down it at the one-yard line, William Gay.
William looked like me playing third base in Little League.
Or Bill Buckner playing first base.
We're right on between his legs. Oh, that's
Let
cruel.
Bill Buckner rest in
that's
peace.
That's cruel.
That's all over. They won the World Series. Cincinnati, luckily, to be starting on the 20 when we come back, not the 1.
ESPN2's College Football Saturday is presented by Hitachi, the ultimate television viewing experience, and in part by Saturn, people first.
Back at Papa John's Cardinal Stadium, 50-degree day that feels an awful lot colder with a 20-mile-an-hour southerly breeze whipping right to left. It is at the back of Colin Carey in the Cincinnati offense as they have it at the 20 and not the 1 thanks to the missed grounder that rolled right by William Gay waiting for it near the goal line on the Louisville punt. So they start in the eye. They have had him tracked the two or three times he's touched it. He has not had a chance, and it's J.T. Haskins up from strong safety to nail Hall.
So here's an example of what Louisville's going to do on defense. They stem their defense to the left. They moved everybody one man. You can't see them, but they've already changed the alignment. Carey runs the play right into the strength of the defense. They're outnumbered. And you end up with a four-yard loss. That's what Louisville's going to do to him all day long because of his inexperience.
The proud Louisville defense, they lead Conference USA in all the categories that their offense does. They just don't get near as many headlines. Hall again attracts a crowd. Six red jerseys surround him with a marker down. Richard Hall, a senior from Cincinnati, transfer from Ohio State, who admits it's all his fault he had to transfer because he didn't take care of his academics. And illegal block is the initial sign against Cincinnati. It looked like a play that even with the illegal blocks
illegal block
didn't go anywhere.
In the back on the offense. The penalty is refused. Result of the play, we have third down.
Two plays ago, real time we watched this.
Is team speed on defense and a defense that's already prearranged for the option going to the wide side.
That secondary player is not honoring the throwing ability of Colin Carey.
Straight up the middle, running all the way. Carey across the 25, and it'll bring up a fourth and four.
That's good patient play calling, and I think Cincinnati has to understand that they're going to have a huge game on defense. They're going to have to sell out on the outside, play man-to-man, take the running game away from Louisville, and be very patient offensively. If this is a 30-40 point day for Louisville, I don't think Mark D'Antonio can get that many points out of Colin Carey at quarterback.
See if Irvin can get it up and use the wind behind him better than he did the first time. Montrell Jones. And running for his life. Jones at the 13. Ball comes loose and is covered at the 9. Louisville ball first and goal. Antoine Harris breaking through for the Cardinals.
I was just standing here thinking about the first cold days that you play in a season, and the texture of the football literally changes so that it gets to be like a watermelon seed. And that thing goes right through your hands if you aren't prepared for it, and that's obviously what happened. Very poor timing for Cincinnati.
Well, regardless of the weather conditions, Irvin's got to make a play on that football. I mean, this is Division I, and you've got to be able to make that catch securely and get the punt off. He let his team down on that play.
Reggie Bradshaw with a recovery, and first and goal, 9-yard line, Louisville. Getting help they don't really need. And hurdling Michael Bush down at the 3-yard line. A former Kentucky Mr. Football, Male High School here in Louisville. They have a trio of former winners of Mr. Football here in the state of Kentucky. And in the red zone, you can't get a whole lot better than Louisville's 90%, 43 of their 51 scores, touchdowns this year.
Yeah, that's 75% touchdown percentage. That's what you want.
Big back this time. Eric Shelton reaches the 1. And that's where it ends, and it's third and goal from there.
Turning Shelton loose on a long touchdown run, dropping the snap at punter. Those are the type of mistakes that Cincinnati needed from Louisville to have a chance in this football game. And if Cincinnati isn't careful early, Bill, this could be a real long day.
Well, they're not being very careful so far, are they?
Not very.
And it's early.
Three tight end look. Motion from Gary Barnidge. Colby Smith in at fullback. And the play fake. LaForge. Zone, he tried to hit Barnidge, covered by Holly, and the Cardinals failed to get six, with the fans yelling that they want to see one more crack at six, and I think they're going to get their wish.
That was a great play by Holly, the cornerback. He had that play diagnosed early, forced LaForge out of the pocket with his coverage.
They never even considered the field goal unit. Fourth and goal, 1 yard line. Of the goal line is Shelton, and the Cincinnati defense comes up with a goal line stand. How
and
about that?
That, Dave and David, is what Cincinnati needs. That's taking care of business in the crunch and making a statement that all that posturing before the game wasn't just making a stand, and they're getting it done on the field.
Mark D'Antonio congratulates his unit. They just kept it 7-0. Cardinals go for it, fourth and one, fourth and goal from the one, and Trent Cole and Doug Monahan come up to foil Shelton, the biggest back they have.
Monahan does a great job of fighting through traffic here, the strong safety, that left shoulder, what a play by the strong safety, and Russell number 30 to come in and finish things off.
So from inside their own one now, trying to gouge out 2 or 3 yards, and that's a pretty good sneak by Colin Carey. He may actually get him all the way to the four. It'll be second down and 7 from there.
That's a very good sneak, and quarterback sneak is an art, and he did it perfectly.
It's a much better sneak than we saw from the Texas quarterback yesterday in single-handedly trying to give Texas A&M a gift win in Austin. Vince Young, I'm assuming, has never heard you lecture on the fine art of the quarterback sneak, as have we. We know how to run it apparently better than Vince showed yesterday.
Violation on the offense. Half the distance to the goal, still second down.
Cincinnati continuing to self-destruct. Their defense gives them a great stand. Their quarterback does a nice job of bringing it off the goal line, and they have a substitution error. You cannot have 12 men in the huddle and have one of them run off.
Even with the mistakes, still a 7-0 ball game. Cincinnati needs to keep their poise, try to fight their way through this first quarter. You want to get your quarterback, your senior second-string quarterback's feet wet and get him into the rhythm of the football game.
One back, two tight end set. And Carey rolling on the play fake, and the catch is made by Doug Jones, a redshirt freshman, as we get an update from Matt Weiner in the studio.
Same Taco Bell takes us to Blacksburg, where Virginia and Virginia Tech are both trying to earn their way to the ACC's BCS slot. Cavaliers break the seal in the third. Marcus Hakins to Alvin Pierman. That after a fumbled Virginia Tech punt return. It's now 7-3. Yahoo!
We had a chance to do that game last year, and last couple of years, Virginia Tech is a rivalry that has really grown in national stature. As you see, J.T. Haskins helped up the fine, strong safety, a senior from Lexington for the Cardinals.
Yeah, sure hope he's okay. What a likable young man he is, and here's the way he got hurt. He ran into the big fella, Doug Jones, who's just a monster tight end. Soft hands and
already limping.
Like somebody, something happened. Either he pulled something, or he got stomped in the arch, or something like that. But JT was kind enough to speak to me down there before the game, and I said, "Do something so we can talk about you." But I didn't want you to get hurt, JT.
Should have been more specific.
Okay. Yeah,
it looked like the injury came just before the reception by Jones. And if you watch, Haskins is going to. He's going to jump on his left foot throughout this tackle. That's where it happened, and he's...
Yeah, his right foot's already up. He's already favoring his right. Something happened with his right ankle. It might have been a previous injury.
Third and less than one, really only about a foot, and they stack three in the eye.
This is a big play here for Cincinnati to move the chains and keep the ball out of the... hands of LaForce.
They run another sneak, and with the second effort, Colin Carey should have the placement for the first down.
Now you don't want to give the ball back to LaForce and his offensive unit at midfield. And I think a big part of this football game, Bill, is going to be field position, working on the clock, trying to shorten the game as far as Cincinnati's concerned.
Gino Gadulli came out, warmed up with the broken bone in his right hand, deemed too serious, too painful to go. And a guy who had never even missed a practice in his Cincinnati career has to watch.
46 games in a row he has played. What a shame in this one.
First start since he was a senior in high school here in Cincinnati for Colin Carey. Drive started at the one-yard line. After the fake to Hall, in trouble, throwing against his momentum, and he throws a strike, bobbled by Hannibal Thomas, and he did not have control when he went out at the 34.
I got to tell you, I like Colin Carey. He's been accurate with his throws. He did that under pressure, running to his left. Look at him get those shoulders squared around. This is such a nice throw under the circumstances. Very difficult, David.
And it's tough to give the viewers at home a feel for the gust, the winds. Bill, you and I were down in the field just before kickoff, and tough for a quarterback to be moving to his left and also throw an accurate ball. The wind took that ball a bit.
Louisville scored on its first play from scrimmage, an 80-yard run by Eric Shelton. But they were stopped on a fourth and goal from the one. Another keeper by Carey, and that's been the best part of their offense so far. He reaches the 18. It'll be third and three.
Well, Don Treadwell, the offensive coordinator for Cincinnati, told us one thing Carey does, he runs better than Gino Gadulli. And Gadulli's a marvelous passer and an adequate runner, but this guy is obviously a threat with the football under his arm. And I like the way he's throwing so far. There's Don there to your right. There's Don.
Forecast of rain, moisture has arrived here at Papa John's Cardinal Stadium. Swing pass into traffic, caught on the deflection. It's going to be now ruled incomplete. Incredibly lucky that time that was an intercepted and run untouched for a touchdown. Ernest Jackson there finally to grab it. Unable to hang on. Cincinnati again fortunate. It's still 7-0.
Yeah, Abe Brown, number 43, had a shot to pick that pass off and walk into the end zone. And every now and then you get a break at quarterback. Colin Carey just got a big break. That should have been returned for six the other way.
Nah, that was the old Carum technique. Hard to teach.
Tip drill, huh, Bill?
A fake with room on the right side. First down. What a call for Cincinnati to get some room out there on the right side, recognize it, and take advantage. And it's Bill Poland, wide receiver, who went back in punt formation and kept for the first down on the fake.
Now, this is great deception, and I can't help but think that Louisville thought Poland came in after Irvin dropped the snap. And what a play at the chains by Poland to turn. He just barely picks up this first down. A nice bit of running, Bill, at the first down stakes.
Yeah. That's one of those heart attacks for the head coach. You make the call and you can't watch.
Hey, he's got to be willing to take whatever the circumstances are to call that play. That spot on the field. Paul has had absolutely no room. The marked man with very little respect or fear for the Cincinnati passing game without Gadulli out there. Richard Hall came in 112 yards from 1,000, and he has gone backward every time they've handed it to him.
Well, we've already shown the viewers how Louisville is loading the box and going into their over defense and moving over to the wide side of the field. What we haven't shown is the fact they're putting 8 and 9 down there to stop the run, and that's the way they're going to play unless Carey can throw the ball a little more accurately.
Loss is 3 more Hall, 4 carries, minus 4 yards. Quarterback draw. And another third and long coming. Monday night, 7:30 Eastern on ESPN. Get ready for Monday Night Football with Monday Night Countdown. And then at 9 Eastern on ABC, Brett Favre and the Green Bay Packers looking for their sixth straight win as they take on Marshall Faulk and the St. Louis Rams. Monday Night Countdown at 7:30 on ESPN. Monday Night Football at 9 on ABC.
And guys, I can't help but feel this is a bit like when D'Antonio was at Ohio State, how they play offense with Krenzel, yep. Play to their defense, a lot of keepers from Krenzel. Same theory.
Third and eight. Great fake out of the offset eye. And the long out. Blocks and is picked off at the 48-yard line by Antoine Harris. Former wide receiver who has played both ways most of his career for the Cardinals until this year.
Well, Hannibal Thomas is going to let down his quarterback. Right here, Hannibal Thomas has to continue his route, and he checks up. You can't let your quarterback down. You got to run that post corner route through the sideline. Didn't read the ball well in the air, quit on the route.
Second interception for the senior corner Harris. And now a bruising Shelton bangs his way to the 40. A pickup of eight.
As a quarterback, Colin Carey expects his go-to receiver to continue that route all the way to the sideline. And another mistake by Cincinnati here early in the first quarter.
And Antoine Harris showing the fact that he had been a wide receiver. A lot of times you'll see DBs drop that ball because that's a tough catch.
Second down and right at two. And again on the ground, Shelton knifing in from tackle Mike Wright for the stop. Former walk-on, an update from Matt Weiner in the studio.
Virginia Tech has finally cracked the Virginia defense. Brian Randall, the senior, playing his final home game in Blacksburg, up top to Josh Hyman, 45 yards in the pitch and catch. Hokies have taken a three-point lead in the third.
That one for the Commonwealth Cup, this one for the Keg of Nails. Surprisingly close, low scoring first quarter. 7-0 Cardinals. The all-time leading receiver in Kentucky high school history, Male High School, right here in Louisville, and another of their former Kentucky Mr. Football Award winners.
Number 17.
You gamble on the outside against this crew of wide receivers, and you're really rolling the dice. And Harwell, cornerback, got burned.
The extra point. Backed on by Art Carmody. Two big plays for the two Louisville scorers. Shelton, 80 yards. First play from scrimmage, 43 yards. Strike here from LaFours to the junior Montrell Jones. And with a minute 17 in the first, 14 up.
Hey, it's me.
Hi.
You want anything from McDonald's?
Whatever. You know what I like.
Sure.
Would have made Johnny U proud, wouldn't it? As his statue stands watch right in front of the Johnny Unitas Football Museum here at Pop John's Cardinal Stadium. Terrific facility in its seventh season of operation. Sold out all but one game this year, and they were about 600 shy of a sellout on that Wednesday. 42,000 plus enjoying 14-0 Cardinals here with two big play scores and a minute 17 to go in the first.
If he saw that statue, he'd say, throwing off the wrong foot.
He's throwing on the run, though. He's being mobile, Johnny Yu. Return from 10-yard line, Mike Daniels. Marked out at the 23.
And Cincinnati going man-to-man. They're going to mostly lock up man-to-man on rundowns. And that's pitch and catch between LaFours and Jones.
We talked about uncanny accuracy when we described Stephon LaFours. And that's what I mean. His guy's wide open. He doesn't overlead him. He doesn't underthrow him. It's a perfect throw.
Larry and Susan, mom and dad, hearing impaired, signing their excitement.
That's neat.
So the Bearcats, only a minute 12 to go with a wind at their back. And Hall, a marked man, with his first positive yardage of the afternoon. I think they'll give him two here into the arms of Amobi Okoye. Last year as a freshman, played as a 16-year-old, the year in the country. Family moved from Nigeria when he was 12. He tested into the ninth grade as a 12-year-old and now a 17-year-old junior. Look at the difference in field position, and Louisville has definitely taken advantage.
315 pounds, 17-year-old.
Yeah. He's advanced physically and mentally. On the roll. Carry. Not on the same page that time as Hannibal Thomas and Ernest Jackson both cut the pattern off short. An update from Matt Weiner.
All right, David, an update on a game of particular interest in the Big 12. Missouri at Iowa State. Brad Smith got a couple of great blocks. He goes untouched 36 yards. The Tigers take a 14-7 lead. Somewhere in Colorado, Gary Barnett is cheering.
Chance for Iowa State to win their first ever Big 12 North Championship, but they must beat Mizzou and continue the Tigers' losing streak. Third and eight. They fake the draw under pressure. Carry, ball knocked loose. And recovered by Cincinnati at the 24. Chad Rimsey coming hard with the pressure from defensive end. Junior out of Oxford, Alabama.
Steve Eastlake just gets beat right now. The big left tackle, Chad Rimsey, just too quick for him off the corner. Carey has no idea what's coming from behind. That's another product of inexperience. There's a sort of a little sixth sense that you develop when you've played a lot, and he just hadn't been out there enough to feel those things.
Louisville timeout with 12 seconds to go. And the backup sees quite a bit of action considering he backs up the top-rated quarterback in the country, Brian Braun, the true freshman from here in Louisville, Trinity High School, USA Today National Offensive Player of the Year last year. And their third former Kentucky Mr. Football Award winner. We'll see him soon. Right now, let's check in with Heather.
Dave, it seems for decades the Browns in Louisville have been synonymous. I think they're the first football family of this city. It began with Oscar Braun, the father. He was a quarterback for the Cardinals back in 1968. Then the legacy was passed down to his three sons. It started with Greg, a wide receiver and starter on the 1991 Fiesta Bowl championship team, now a director of football operations here. Then passed down to Jeff, a three-year starter at quarterback, two-time MVP, who went on to an NFL career, now is quarterback coach to his younger brother, Brian. No surprise. Now the quarterback here, considered the biggest recruit in Louisville history. I think you're a lifer if you're a Brom and you play for Louisville.
I'd say so. Well, the Louisville timeout allows Cincinnati to come into the wind, and they block it and return it for a touchdown. Didn't matter wind or no, Brandon Johnson with the touchdown return for the Cardinals. Their third big play score here in the first quarter, and they'll be flagged for the celebration.
Brandon Johnson got the punt as well. He made the block, he made the scoop, and he made the touchdown.
When you watch Louisville play defense, the guy that stands out for speed and pursuit is 97, Brandon Johnson. He comes, takes the ball right off the punter's foot, and he's back on his feet and into the end zone with it.
Carmody for the PAT. Fourth blocked punt for Johnson. The other three all came 2 years ago. He tied for first in the nation that year with his teammate, Curry Burns.
Yeah, Coach D'Antonio's punt unit has really turned, you know, their attempts into adventures. First of all, it was a drop by Irvin. The successful fake by Poland. And now the block. What a play by Johnson. I mean, he closed on the punter in a hurry there, Bill.
Well, he's got such amazing closing speed. We hadn't had a chance to see him do that on defense today, but I'm sure we will. He can really fly.
He has now blocked four in his career and returned two for touchdowns. Be sure to join us tomorrow night on ESPN for Sunday Night Football, as this week Kerry Collins and the Oakland Raiders travel to Denver to take on Jake Plummer and the Broncos. Coverage begins with NFL Primetime presented by Miller Lite at 7:30 Eastern. And then a classic from the AFC and even AFL historical vaults. Raiders, Broncos. Just thought it was odd they called that timeout and allowed Cincinnati to punt with the wind. They obviously knew the wind was going to have no factor whatsoever on that play.
They didn't care.
Didn't matter to Brandon.
This is turning into the head coach's ultimate nightmare when your quarterback can't go and everything else that you hoped had happened for would happen for you is happening against you.
Kickoff is a fair caught by Anthony Hoke with still 5 seconds to go in the first quarter. And what hurts worse if you're Geno now, David Norrie, the hand or the fact that you have to stand and watch helplessly your team falling behind 21-0?
Well, it's a tough situation when you're a quarterback, especially a quarterback that can have the impact on a game that Geno Gadduly does. I mean, he's one of the better quarterbacks across the country, and a chance to knock off a top 10 BCS team just didn't happen today.
Still no room for Richard Hall, fourth leading rusher in Conference USA. As the first quarter comes to a close, a big play Louisville offense augmented by the special teams. An 80-yard touchdown run by Shelton, 43-yard pass LaForest to Jones, and the block punt returned by Johnson, 21-0. Back in Cincinnati, where it's rather dank, cold, wet, windy, and if you're a Bearcat, depressing. It's 21-0. They had it 7-0 until the last couple minutes of that quarter, and then things got out of hand very quickly. Now they have to go into the 20-mile-an-hour breeze from their 22-yard line to begin the second quarter. Carry all the way at quarterback, fake to Hall, and Doug Jones with his second catch and gets near the 30-yard line to bring up a third and short. Our Yamaha game track full of big plays for the Cardinals. First play from scrimmage, barely touched. Eric Shelton with the longest run of the year for the Cardinals. 80 yards, just like that, 7-0. And then the Brandon Johnson special, he blocked it, he recovered it, he returned it. Late in the quarter. Make it 21-0 in between a 43 yards Stephon LaFour's touchdown pass to Montrell Jones. They have outgained Cincinnati 164-18 in total yardage as Hannibal Thomas, their leading receiver, makes his first catch of the afternoon.
Well, first things first for Cincinnati in this ballgame in the first quarter. You want to give your quarterback a chance. And even though he's a senior, Colin Carey is a young quarterback. I mean, this is his first start, and you don't execute the rudimentary things, special teams. The punt team has really taken Carey out of this football game, and now you really have to abandon the run game early in this football game.
What run game there is, they carried it 15 times. They have 3 yards. And this is Butler Benton on his first carry, the toss to the true freshman out of Detroit, 3 times. All-city selection there.
Well, and Dave, when you abandon the run game, obviously the run game, you're not going to get a lot of production.
Here's what Louisville's doing. They're just ganged up. There's so many people in the box. We've got 9 people tackled to tight end, and there are just too many people to block.
Kurt McCarley's stat of the day so far. Average gain on first down, Louisville, 17.3 yards. Cincinnati average on first, 0.13 yards. Barry running for his life again, off the hands of his intended target at the 36-yard line, who was open, would have been a short gain anyway. Hannibal Thomas with the drop, and a wet, cold, depressed, hurting physically and emotionally, no doubt. Geno Gadduly, the senior from Fort Thomas, Kentucky, sees what the Cincinnati offense without him looks like. Cincinnati had won their last four games coming in, averaging 460 yards and 42 points per game. They were, with Gaudulli at the controls, playing by far their best of the season, maybe the best of the 4 years he's been their quarterback. And another drop off the hands of Ernest Jackson. So the few times that Colin Carey gets an open target, they have to at least do their part. And Jackson and Thomas each fail on the last two snaps. David, that's probably best pass of the day.
He's throwing a lot of accurate balls in this football game, and you've got to get solid play around him offensively, defensively, and special teams to give him a chance in this football game. I think Carey has responded well in this situation. Down 21-0. It's going to be tough to come back against this Louisville team.
Whistles and flags everywhere before the snap. Carey, 4 of 11 now with an interception and 18 yards.
What you hope when you lose your star, especially at the quarterback position, is that everybody else picks it up a notch. Here's the
prior
call.
Prior to the snap, false start on the offense, number 59. The 5-yard penalty, remains fourth down.
And what we're seeing from Cincinnati is just the opposite. Mistakes in the kicking game, mistakes in substitutions, dropped balls, movement. There's no excuse for moving when you're a punt protector. Everything that can go wrong is going wrong for Cincinnati. It's in the minds of the players that it's happening.
Jermaine Wilson flag. High snap. Handled by Chet Irvin. And into the wind now. Very returnable punt all the way for Montrell Jones. Tripped up, keeps his balance, and runs it all the way in. But there is a marker back near midfield. 66 yards on the return if it stands on a 37-yard punt by Irvin.
Now this is coming back.
Montrell Jones already one touchdown on a 43-yard catch and run, but apparently not this time on the punt return.
Illegal block in the back. Number 34 on the return team. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
Ray Childs gets the flag for the Cardinals.
Ray Childs, just at the time that the Bearcats need a hand, he lends them one with a very foolish block. What a penalty.
And it remains 21-0 Louisville. So we get our first look at the true freshman quarterback, Brian Brohm, out of that Brohm family of Louisville football royalty. This time a year ago, wrapping up a third state championship season with an undefeated Trinity High School team. He steps right in as the USA Today Offensive National Player of the Year and gets plenty of time behind the nation's passing leader this year. The fours gives way at the 38th on a first down and a keeper after the fake to Michael Bush. Brohm hit hard after a pickup of four. Today's Aflac trivia question involves the man he just replaced, Stephon LaForce, who has a career completion mark of 65.5%. Who owns the NCAA career mark?
David Norrie.
I was well below that. By a couple percentage points.
It's not David Norrie, but here's your hint. It involves
prior
another member
snap,
of our little broadcast
start
team.
On the offense, number 82. The 5-yard penalty remains second down.
Gary Barnage.
Let me show you something that I've never seen in my life in football. That is a butt roll, a 360 butt roll, which is a drill that defensive linemen do. I don't know if they lost their minds.
Have you still not seen the movie Friday Night Lights? Because on the key play, the defensive lineman does that in the movie.
If you're going to do this, you do this before you get down 21-0.
All four of them didn't do it in the movie, though.
Wow.
I mean, Bill, we saw Cincinnati before the kickoff go and start whooping at Louisville and jump around and get people upset. I don't understand what Cincinnati's doing.
The give this time to Bush. Close to the first down of the 47.
The one thing you don't want to do is come out and incite the number 10 team in the country.
Matt Weiner with an update in the studio.
Well, nothing quite that creative, but Virginia, a chance to get back into the football game, or to retake the lead, I should say. But on third goal, Marcus Hagans can't find the pylon. They settle for a field goal, so we're tied up in Blacksburg at 10 apiece.
Tied up there, all Cardinals here. 21-0. Third and one. Back to Shelton. Two broken tackles. Finally wrestled down inside the 42. The Bearcats have no answer for the 247-pound junior tailback. 11 yards gets him already 100 on the afternoon.
Well, I have a suggestion for Cincinnati, and that would be to take on the guy that's blocking you, get off the block and make a tackle instead of diving and getting your head behind the runner and letting him rip through you like he did on the long run. And again here, about four tacklers. That'd be my suggestion.
He is about 45 pounds bigger than his fullback, Colby Smith, who helped clear that gigantic hole for him. Rob going deep. J.R. Russell wide open at the goal line. Holds it in. Another big play. Cardinal touchdown. 42 yards.
So, David, you'd say that's caused by incitement? You think they incited Louisville?
I think you let a sleeping dog lie. And Cincinnati, with their actions before the kickoff, almost inciting a riot out at midfield. And then some of those stunts by the defensive linemen. You don't do that when you're down 21-0. And now you're down four touchdowns.
59 out of 59 now on PATs. J.R. Russell blows right past Jeremy Jackson for the fourth Louisville score.
ESPN2 College Football Saturday, brought to you by Budweiser. Grab a cold, fresh Budweiser. It's game time. And Chrysler. Inspiration comes standard.
Well, probably the most famous high tops in Louisville, maybe all of football, the very young number 16,
yeah,
Johnny Unitas.
Looks funny in 16.
The classic flat top pose, etched in the statue down in front of the museum to our left. As Todd Flannery lays into it, very high return from the 20-yard line. And out to the 33 is the return by Anthony Hoke, and another update from Matt Weiner.
Dave, Phil Fulmer reaching deep into the playbook to get his team back into the game with Kentucky down by 9. Rick Clawson over to C.J. Payton, and he's going to throw it. Heaves it downfield to Robert Meacham. 52 yards the play will go, and the balls will cash in. Clawson, this time a little more conventionally to Tony Brown for the touchdown. And it is now a two-point game in Knoxville, 31-29. Still plenty of time.
Well, still plenty of time for the Bearcats to have their say here as well. But they're not helping themselves at all. It is one disaster after another. And Richard Hall hops on that fumble before that can turn into another in the seeming unending series of miscues by the Bearcats.
That's just carelessness. The ball has to be slipped into the pocket. And again, inexperience. Colin Carey just not having a whole lot. And here we are again with a chance to show you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's hard to see him in there, but just too many bodies. Even had the handoff been successful, too many people to run the football.
This has been their best play. The quarterback draw, because it doesn't lose yardage.
But even in long yardage situations, now we got third and long, Louisville's still going to come up there and line up so that Cincinnati can't run the football. Just got too many people, not enough blockers.
And when you have a situation where the weather's deteriorating and the rain's starting to come down hard, such an advantage in the first quarter to jump out on top, because now Louisville can afford to play eight men in the box. You give up a long touchdown, you're still up three touchdowns, and I look for Louisville to continue to load it up in the box.
Under center on third and 10. Play fake. Nobody open. Over the middle into traffic and almost intercepted. Intended for Bill Polian. Nearest man to it was Kerry Rhodes, the leading interceptor for the Cardinals.
Just watching this, David, you get the feeling that if Kerry had any experience in games, that he's really got the basics to be a pretty good player.
I've been impressed. I mean, even before the rain started coming down, there was some wind down on the field. He threw some nice balls. His team did not give him a chance in the first quarter. The special teams errors really cost him an opportunity to be effective at quarterback.
Polian, last time he dropped back, remember, kept it on the fake punt and got the first down. Time a rugby-like effort and enough of a roll that this will be a decent effort. About half of it because of the roll. Dead finally at the 25. And he gets 41 yards out of it. 9:06, second quarter, 28-0, number 8 Louisville. We've seen Louisville look like the nation's number one offense, but we've also seen that they are not a one-sided crew that Bobby Petrino puts out there. The defense has held Cincinnati to 6 yards rushing, 24 yards total. The special teams have contributed a touchdown on a block punt. This is a team blowout in progress, and this is Michael Bush. Broken tackles all the way to the 44 of the Bearcats. And 31 yards on the latest big play by the Cardinals.
Well, Michael Bush is a fine player, but this is just not much effort from the Cincinnati defenders. Andre Frazier, Mike Wright, two guys that are normally very reliable, just reaching, not running through tackles, just falling on the ground. A demoralized Cincinnati team, obviously.
Well, Bill, I think their defense may have wasted too much energy stomping on the logo before the game.
Well, that's possible.
Offense of the next couple of years on display now. The freshman Braun, the sophomore Bush, and that one's off the hand of Barnage, the tight end. Let's get an update from Matt Weiner.
All right, Virginia Tech has retaken the lead in their contest with Virginia. ACC, BCS implications. Brian Randall lofts it up. Josh Hyman on the underthrown ball makes the adjustment. Hokies back on top, 17-10.
That one with just over 5 minutes to go. 8.5 to go. Second quarter here. Dave Barnett, Bill Curry, David Knorr, and Heather Cox. And rain-soaked Papa John's Cardinal Stadium in Louisville. Again, it's Bush. And for a guy listed third string at tailback behind Shelton and Lionel Gates, who we haven't seen today, 11 more yards.
He's not a third string back. This is one of the biggest stable of backs that I've ever seen in college football. And we got Bush going 6'3", 240. Gates, who's out today, he's a 6-foot, 225-pounder. And, of course, we've seen plenty of Shelton at 6'2", 247. And this offensive line, I mean, Bobby Petrino has talked about this offensive line all year long as really being the catalyst for the numbers that have been posted.
The back that Cincinnati was most worried about today was Lionel Gates. Not Shelton, who's got 99 yards, or Bush, who has 62 already. Bush at it again, inside the 15. Three straight carries for double figures each time. 19 yards this time. He's up to 81 yards.
You said it, David. Travis LeFou, Jason Spitz, Will Rabatine, the other offensive linemen, don't get their names called much, but they are the reason that this stuff happens.
Down to Heather Cox.
Well, after seeing the performance Michael Bush is having, how much does it surprise you to learn that a year ago he was actually the backup quarterback and told me he'd rather be the number two, even the number three quarterback, over being a wide receiver or a running back? A year ago didn't have a position, now a star.
Eddie's changed his mind a little bit on that one. Another broken tackle to get him two or three through the middle.
Number 36 is
tomorrow. The top safety recruit in the country. He was, again, a Mr. Football for Kentucky, male high school here in Louisville. Six different positions he started at in high school. including as a senior quarterback, but most recruited him with safety in mind, and turns into one of the more dangerous young running backs in the country. Seven carries, 82 yards. Rom with a fade for Russell and hauled it in out of bounds. J.R. Russell, his only catch so far, has a 42-yard touchdown. Came close on this one. Came close to a push-off, too.
These wide receivers are physical on the outside. Man-to-man, fade route, the hand play at the line of scrimmage.
Oh, that's a serious push-off. That's a very effective push-off, and it should have been detected.
Brom needs to keep the ball in bounds. As a quarterback, you want to give your wide receiver an opportunity to make that play in the back of the end zone.
Third and nine. Jones in motion. He has a touchdown. Brom, plenty of time. Over the middle, inside the five, down to the goal line and in. Another touchdown from Montrell Jones. 13 yards. A machine functioning at peak production, this Cardinal offensive attack.
They bring Jones in motion, and somebody ran the wrong route here, Bill. You got two wide receivers in the same area, 45, big number 45.
Yeah, that's a tight end, McCauley.
Even when they mess up, they score.
Yeah, McCauley ran a drag, and he was right in the way of the receiver. Turned out that he just turned up and became a key blocker.
Yeah, McCauley's probably running the wrong route here. You want to distribute your wide receiver. Still a great job by Brom in the pocket. And what protection he's getting.
Well, when you're
settling down.
And when you win like this, David, it's fun to watch the tapes and somebody says, hey, McCauley, that was a mistake. Yeah, but I was just running interference, coach.
Well, it might not have been the wrong route. The depths weren't optimum, but I think that they probably are running the right routes. The depth for McCauley was a little bit off, and still Brom makes things happen. He is an NFL type body with an NFL talent arm.
Two completions, they've both gone for touchdowns. What is an efficiency rating when every completion produces a touchdown? That's a question Louisville fans are more qualified to answer than probably anywhere else in the country, because Stephon LaFors, who was sitting watching Brian Brom put on this show in the second quarter, has right now the top quarterback rating, top efficiency rating anyone has ever had for a single season.
195. That is almost off the charts.
Todd Flannery again with a high short kick, fair caught at the 20 by Hoke, and an update from Matt Winder in the studio.
Today, Virginia Tech has struck again against Virginia. This is Cedric Humes, and the big fellow finds a little space, takes advantage, and pulls away 37 yards on the score. The Hokies have taken a 14-point advantage with 5 minutes and change to go in Blacksburg. In Ames, Iowa, Iowa State finishes off a 62-yard drive. Stevie Hicks in from 2 yards out. That game is tied with the Big 12 North title hanging in the balance.
And the chance to get one would think absolutely demolished by Oklahoma. That's what we thought last year. Kansas State had other ideas. Perry sacked by Montavious Stanley.
We've really given short shrift to the Louisville defense, talking so much about the offense, but big Montavious Stanley has been dominant all year long. You see 92 just continuing to push up the field, good hand strength, got a hold of the shoulder pad, got the big quarterback on the ground.
Bill, when we watched film this week of this Louisville defense, I thought Stanley was the guy that really jumped off the film. He's always disruptive in the backfield, makes a lot of plays behind the line of scrimmage.
Loss of 7, second and 17. Pocket ending in a sack by Elvis Dumerville, joined this time by Bobby LaFeu. Even when Colin Carey gets some time to throw, there's nobody to throw it to, and eventually they're going to get to him.
Bear in mind, during the Gadooley streak, this offensive line While he completed 71% for over 1,000 yards, there were zero interceptions and really zero sacks. There was one time he was run out of bounds for a two-yard loss last week. He said that doesn't count as a sack. They've given up no sacks in four games, and now they're really running into problems here. A tough day.
What was really impressive coming in, they had a total of 24 sacks by 11 different players. That's how they spread it around and let everybody get involved here. Marcus Jones, deflection. And the hand for the defensive unit of Louisville now as they come off, having driven Cincinnati back 12 yards after the first and 10. This started as a sellout of 42,000, and as it's gotten colder and wetter, only the hearty half of that total may be still here with them. Still over 5 minutes to go in the first half.
People walking vigorously to their automobiles out in the parking lot.
Almost blocked. Poland again, rugby style effort. Jones on the return. Fumbled. And recovered at the 18-yard line by Cincinnati. John Carpenter with about the only thing that's gone right for the Bearcats all day.
The officials have the job to keep the ball manageable, and we get a chance to see Jones again. He handles the ball very well until he's hit. He seems to have it secured properly, and suddenly just slides out.
And the punter, Poland, causes that fumble. He kicks it 30. Jones returns it 20. John Carpenter, son of former NFLer Rob Carpenter, gets the recovery with 4:57 to go in the half, and the Bearcats gain a few yards on that exchange. They need every yard they can get. Mercy, do they ever? Minus six rushing. 12 total yards as Butler Benton looks for the corner on the sweep. True freshman, second leading rusher. Nearing 400 yards on the season.
Yeah, really a case of what might have been. I mean, the four-game winning streak for Cincinnati. Gadooly last week, 30 for 36. That winning streak was against really four of the top five teams in Conference USA. And a healthy Gadooly coming into this football game, you can't help but think what might have been.
Now, Louisville might still have 35, but Cincinnati might very well not have none. The offense out there, at least they have a chance to match it score for score. Carey, yard or so shy on the keeper. Now let's answer today's Aflac trivia questions. Stephon LaForest, career completion percentage 65.5%. Holder of the NCAA career mark, recruited by Bill Curry to Kentucky, that would be Tim Couch, 67.1% at the University of Kentucky in his career.
I do know out at UCLA in the mid-80s, we had a quarterback that threw for 69% in one season. That was Rick Neuheisel.
And we're talking career here. They can't get the handoff exchange without bobbling. And the recovery at the 25 by Louisville. They take it right back. Bradley Gladauer had come into the backfield. And things go amok again for the Bearcats.
Really a house of horrors for Cincinnati. And that was Jones, the big fullback, who got into the football. There's a bit of a problem, the mesh between the quarterback and the fullback, and that created some mishandling of the football before Carey tried to hand the ball off. Really one of the reasons why Gadooly couldn't go as well. Not able to handle the football, the snap, the handoffs behind the line of scrimmage, and Carey with a healthy right hand having a tough time.
Back in is LaForest, and he turns complete down to the 11-yard line. Tight end Adam McCauley, an update from Matt Weiner.
Kentucky hasn't beaten Tennessee since 1984, and for the first time in this game, they trailed. Gerald Riggs, 12 yards, finds the checkerboard. They go for two and make it. Vols lead inside a minute to go by six.
Well, Bill Kerr's prediction coming truer by the second there in Volunteer Land. On first down, Colby Smith, sophomore fullback, with the carry and down near the 5-yard line. This is, or was, a sold-out house of 42,000 plus at Papa John's Cardinal Stadium. All Louisville, with Gino Gadulli sitting this one out, first miss of his career with a broken bone in his throwing hand. He came out, warmed up. Too painful to go, so he has watched a Cardinal masterpiece of the first half in all phases of the game. About to add to a 35-0 lead, and LaFleur's, as he sees movement across the line, takes the quick snap and gets the flags down.
LaFleur's does so many things well at quarterback, Bill. An example there of using the hard count at the line of scrimmage.
They're just practicing all their stuff today, and everything's working. That was the old freeze count. Center got the ball up. LaFleur's takes a knee. Defense offside. So you get a little closer to the goal line before you hand it off to another one of those monsters or run a little waggle or a boot and flip it to one of those big tight ends. They're just virtually unstoppable, even when you're playing well against them. And Cincinnati's not having a good day, obviously.
Second and one for the first. Two for the touchdown. The extra effort, touchdown Smith. His first touchdown. Fullback who averages on his few carries this year better than 8 yards per carry. He had never lost yardage. No one had ever caught him for a loss. Always going forward, and it goes forward for the 2-yard touchdown. His first on the ground. He had one touchdown catch this year, and another PAT by Art Carmody. 2:48 to go in the half. It is now 42 and counting for the Cardinals. Where it will all stop, nobody knows today. Well, nothing is more synonymous with baseball than the Louisville Slugger. The museum and factory here churn out nearly 1,800 baseball bats a day. And if you're good and well-connected, you can even get a personalized bat just like the pros.
Wow.
And in our case, we could not be more delighted or more thankful. We have our own Louisville Slugger.
That's right. And we have our associate, Ben Cerny, to thank for this. I always wanted my name on a baseball bat, but it wasn't exactly this way that I intended to get it on there.
But you're not giving it back, are you?
Oh, no. I'm going to keep it.
Not quite anything like the feel of one of these babies.
Battering. Another high short kick and the return out across the 30 by Jones. Well, boy, I don't know how many years ago this would have gotten a real workout, but as it is, with that name there, this is going to have a prized place in the office.
Bill, well, I heard you were upset that they didn't hollow out the top of the bat for you. You know, it's
I don't even know what that means or what that's for. I like it like this.
Don't cork it, okay?
No.
Whatever you do.
Okay, I don't know what that does either, but I got two grandsons that are going to enjoy this a lot.
2:42 in the first half, and after Colin Carey had got all the way at quarterback now, George Murray will take a stab at it. Wide receiver who's also played some quarterback in his Cincinnati history. Another update from Matt Weiner.
All right, Dave, coming up at the half, Virginia and Virginia Tech play for the Commonwealth Cup and a chance at the ACC title. We've got the latest results there. The Big East BCS representative still not decided thanks to an upset in progress up on Chestnut Hill, plus the Iowa State Cyclones. The Big 12 North title coming down to the wire. It's all up next at the half.
All right. We are exactly 2 minutes away. Murray to the air for the first time and incomplete at the 45 intended for Thomas. George Murray, who has been a wideout all year, high school quarterback, who has split time throughout his career at Cincinnati. Two rushing touchdowns at that position last year. Year before that, 2002, he was 5 out of 10 through the air. 2001, 8 for 14. And with no real designated 13 quarterback behind Colin Carey and Gadulli, they really went all week with a question in the mind of the coaches. What would we do if Colin Carrig were to go down or were to be ineffective? And they went back and forth and finally decided they would move a man who was not totally unfamiliar with the quarterback spot back out there. And in this case, it's Murray keeping and picking up the first down, the 47-yard line. Already, he's got the most effective Bearcat possession of the first half going. A 14-yard keeper, that's their best play yardage-wise here in the first half.
Well, Murray played quarterback at Rickards High down in Tallahassee, Florida. Showed a propensity to run the football as well as throw it pretty well. And this is a tough, this is really a tough kind of call to get, go from third string to first string in a matter of plays. A nice little stiff arm there at the end of the run.
From the 48. Maybe a yard, but he paid a heavy price for that short game. Yeah, the man Brandon, he had just stiff-armed gets his revenge
Brandon
now.
Brandon Johnson with a little payback. Yeah. You go bust me in the mouth, man. I'm going to bust you in your mouth, too.
Payback is a little more severe when the temperature dips down below 40 degrees.
Boom. Nice tackle. Good shot. I really like Brandon Johnson. He reminds me of a guy named Charles Haley that played for the 49ers and the Dallas Cowboys for many years. Just rangy and so fast, so athletic.
When he fills out that body, I think he's going to be a heck of an outside linebacker, defensive end at the pro level.
Johnson, who has a block punt, returned it himself for a touchdown. On second and eight, Murray wide open, incomplete. An underthrow with Ernest Jackson running a step behind the coverage.
And Jackson had Gay beat on the outside. Murray gets that ball up, that might be a touchdown. Seen a lot of man-to-man from both teams in the secondary. Jackson just runs right by Gay. Tries to gear down on that catch. Throwing into the wind. Or he's got to put a little bit more on that football.
When you're in a wounded situation, especially with the QB, everybody else has got to make the big plays, and they just aren't coming today for Cincinnati. Jackson could have caught that ball, David.
Well, not nearly the factor it was for the opening kick. On the roll, deciding to keep now. And gang tackled at the 45. Antoine Sharp with the first hit. They have three timeouts. And finally, the whistle with 18 seconds for the first of those three.
Now you'd think that Cincinnati might consider one of a couple other options, like number one, warming up the bus, or number two, getting into the locker room here. Not a fun afternoon for Coach D'Antonio.
But how could you have a lot more fun than Stephon LaForce is having? First of all, he was honored along with the other Cardinal seniors on Senior Day. Father Larry, Mom Susan on the field with him. And he's 4-for-6 through the air. Brian Brohm, 2-for-4. And they have combined for 3 touchdowns. Both Brahms completions good for scores. 4 out of 6 for the fours. And a 43-yard touchdown thrown to Montrell Jones. 19 seconds to go. The parents may be the last people braving the elements this afternoon at Cardinal Stadium.
Oh, yeah. The moms and dads will sit right here no matter how cold it is to watch that young man play.
They're usually the last to go.
A 4th and 2. So Cincinnati first has got to get those 2 yards, and then they can get 2-3 more plays off with 2 timeouts still at their disposal. From the 44. And had a chance to snap it in Cardinal territory here in the first half. Long roll, short toss, and caught inbounds by Thomas. So they get the first down with 13 seconds to go.
When you get in a spot like this, meaning what Coach D'Antonio is dealing with, you just want to get some execution, get something going, get some shred of dignity. Try to get some points on the board. Get in there at the halftime and really work on your tackling reminders, blocking, catching, basics.
Three wides right. And again, looking on the roll, running out of room. And that leaves just 4 seconds on the clock. Chased by Chad Rimsey. Murray finally ran out of room along the near sideline. Time for one more snap.
At least you can throw a big bend in the end zone from this field position and hope it gets batted around and one of your guys can come down with it, and at least you got points on the board.
Yeah, you cut the lead to 35. You're right back in this football game, Bill.
Don't spoil it for me.
Same look. This time all three wide go deep. And the deep pass intercepted by Kerry Rhodes. His fifth team-leading interception of the year. LaFleur is the most efficient quarterback in the country. Didn't hurt himself at all. 4 out of 6, 73 yards and a score. All Louisville, 42-0 as we send it back to Matt in the studio. Who is guarding all the gold at Fort Knox? And don't our soldiers do enough already? Why must they sit through a rainy, cold 42-0 game that started on the very first play from scrimmage? This 80-yard Eric Shelton sprint set the tone. And the Cardinals took it on the ground, in the air, with a long J.R. Russell touchdown catch, and through the special teams with the Brandon Johnson block punt return it himself for a touchdown. And that's our Yamaha game track, and that's a 42-0 stomping that the Cardinals are putting on Cincinnati, who never got a chance to test Gino Gadulli with a broken hand. He has not played at all, obviously won't anymore. Where do you go from here if you're Cincinnati, Bill? My first question is, what in the world did Mark D'Antonio find to say to his players in the halftime locker room?
The only thing you can say at a time like this is we find out in the second half who really wants to be a football player, because this is really a time when you can come out here and establish some respect and at least play like a football team.
I think what you do here is you go over your keys on your punt team again at halftime. And you get that button down first, and then you go from there.
Good.
Rain has picked up steadily since it began the first quarter. And the second half kick returned by Mike Daniels out across the 30. And let's check in with a damp but game Heather Cox down on the sideline.
And indeed, I might use the word soaked instead of damp. I did have a chance to talk to Coach D'Antonio coming out of the locker room, obviously very frustrated. I asked, what's your philosophy for the second half? And he said, self-respect, that is all it's about. There's no chance we'll see Gino Gadulli in the second half. We will see George Murray first, and they still will use Colin Carey if need be, guys.
All right. And when he came in late in the first half, George Murray moved the offense, for what it's worth, better than they had at any point before he came in. Mostly on his keepers. Break to Richard Hall. And the throw on the run is tipped and almost intercepted by Antoine Harris, who already has one pick. Hitachi first half stats. Most of it on the ground for the Cardinals. 329-50 in total offense. The average start of a drive was at their 47-yard line. Cincinnati started at its 21. Average first down carry for Louisville went 16 yards. For Cincinnati, it was a yard. Three Bearcat turnovers and a block punt and a muff punt. Louisville turned it over but once. Hard to play closer to a perfect half than the Cardinals did. Keeper for maybe a half yard. That includes the Louisville defense. When Colin Carey was in, he rarely had time to throw. And as they have all year, the sack masters for Louisville spread the wealth. They came in with 11 different players accounting for their 24 sacks for the season. It's not just one or two guys you got to worry about blocking if you're Cincinnati, because the trouble can come from anywhere. Third and 9. Hannibal Thomas through his hands and incomplete. Matt Weiner in the studio.
Dan, Big 12 championship game is set. Missouri and Iowa State into overtime. 17-14, third and goal. Brett Meyer throwing A.J. Kincaid with the pick from Mizzou. And Gary Barnett, a Missouri graduate, gets a gift from his alma mater. Colorado will play Oklahoma in the Big 12 title game.
Wow, Missouri ends its losing streak and prevents Iowa State from its first Big 12 North appearance in the championship game. And Iowa State had that game in front of them. They missed a chip shot field goal to force the overtime. They're caught at the 27 by Montrell Jones. So the Cardinals will have it for the first time in the second half, which may not include much of LaFour's. We'll see when we come back. Post time today was about 2:35 local time, right next door to Churchill Downs at Papa John's Cardinal Stadium. Stephon LaFour's does start the second half with a 42-0 lead at his 28.
I think Cincinnati got stuck in the gate.
And LaFour's has a drop to his wide-open tight end, Adam McCauley. An update from Matt Weiner.
Dave, Syracuse has messed up the Big East in all sorts of ways. There's now a four-way tie at the top. Syracuse becomes bowl eligible with a 43-17 win over Boston College. It puts Pittsburgh in the driver's seat. Assuming they beat South Florida next week, the Panthers are likely to get the Big East BCS spot.
That's what's great about the BCS. Pittsburgh and Auburn will probably be in the same situation. They get a BCS bowl.
Second down and 10. Shelton went 80 yards on the first play. About 5 yards here. The tone was set perhaps before the opening kick. What in the world were the Bearcats thinking of? Who did they think this was going to benefit? Going out and stomping on the midfield logo. Bobby Petrino, head coach, comes out and leads the Louisville protest. Now, to their credit, they didn't let it turn into
officials came out and ushered them away.
They didn't let it become a brawl, which so many times we've seen.
The Louisville players ignored the insult.
Took it out on them.
Juvenile thing to do. They just came out and ran up 42 on them in the first half.
That's how they took it out on them.
They hung about a half a hundred on them in the first half of the game.
Yeah. There's the response right there. You know, they ignored that those antics until the opening kickoff. And Bobby Petrino, Bill, you and I were down about 14 steps away from there.
I thought it could get ugly, and it didn't.
Bobby Petrino was using some language that wouldn't be appropriate for some of our younger viewers.
Well, the language that describes what Cincinnati did is Bush. No class shown by their players, and they are getting exactly what they deserve, a 42-0 embarrassment. Louisville players putting it in their faces on the field.
Well, now, David, you're a younger viewer. Are you offended or something? I mean, you hadn't heard. Your sensibilities were really moved by such language?
I actually blushed down on field level, Bill. My ears were wilting.
Jamar Enzor, middle linebacker, being helped off.
I'll tell you, I think you are more interesting in blowouts than you are in regular games, Dave.
And aren't we glad?
Yes. We want you to continue with the wit. I guess that's what we could call that so far.
Well, like I said, it's a good thing that BCS system's working this year.
You know, Mac Brown,
jumping all over that one.
Mac Brown's addressed this all week, and he says, I thought that the BCS was there to reward the top eight teams in the country. And I found out the hard way it's only about the top two teams in the country, and everybody else is in the middle of a big crapshoot, which apparently will again fall not Texas's way this year. Boston College had a chance to play their way probably to the Fiesta and blew it today at home against Syracuse. as Russell makes the catch for the first down.
Well, David, not only Texas, but how about Auburn? I mean, if these top three teams win out, Auburn's going to go and play a two-loss team, most likely in the Sugar Bowl. Auburn's going to just, that's how they get rewarded for an undefeated season, if they do indeed win the SEC championship game. But my even stronger point is, Americans love a Cinderella story. You know, the miracle on ice at Lake Placid, Villanova over Georgetown, Valvano out on the court. This BCS system does not allow Cinderella a date to the ball. And not, they can't show up at the ball. They don't have a shot.
LaFours will decide to keep and run out at the 46. 7:45 Eastern tonight at ESPN. 10th-ranked Boise State, pretty good Cinderella itself, as they try to remain undefeated and join Utah in cracking the top six of the BCS standings. They visit the Nevada Wolfpack on College Football Saturday primetime, presented by Crestor, 7:45 p.m. Eastern on ESPN.
And the bottom line is, Utah starts the season, they have absolutely no chance to be in that championship game, and it may turn out that way for Auburn. I don't think it's a good system.
And the Big East champion this year will get a spot it doesn't deserve, and the Conference USA champion Louisville will not get a spot it deserves, as Colby Smith tries to reverse field and backs his way to his 45. Now next year Louisville and Cincinnati will move into that revamped Big East and have a chance to play for a bid, but it's just 1 year too late, unfortunately.
But it's very likely that if one of those teams goes undefeated, they still won't be able to be in the championship game by virtue of where they're ranked before the season starts. You know, a.k.a. Auburn.
Big East will welcome these two, and South Florida also out of the Conference USA. Both bands at halftime acknowledging that transition by together forming CUSA and then turning that into Big East. Jones has two touchdowns.
Bill, you've become eerily quiet.
Anytime I'm quiet, I suppose that's eerie, but I got to tell my old umpire story here. The old umpire standing out behind the first baseline, and fly balls hit down the right field line, and both managers are running at it. It's fair, it's foul. He said, it ain't nothing till I call it. Well, the BCS is not anything until it's over. So all this stuff you're doing is speculating. Any of these things may or may not happen. And yes, there are imbalances built into the system because that's inevitable. That's the way with any, even if we had a playoff system, similar problems.
Brent Moody's punt out at the 28, just 26 yards. Not that it matters much. Part of a sellout at 42,000 when we began a couple hours ago. Soldiers from Fort Knox who are steadfastly staying rain at all. There's Bonds high in the end zone watching this 42-0 romp by number 8 Louisville. Well, as we speak, now they're finally releasing them.
Yeah, they ought to get hazardous duty pay.
Or eat a free pizza from Papa John's, maybe. Cincinnati ball. Murray still at quarterback. And on the carry, first time Mike Daniels takes it. And he angles out after a gain of about 3.
Well, Bill, I'm curious, not to keep beating a dead horse, but what if you do end up with 3 undefeated teams at the end of the year? Do you think any one of those 3 teams deserves to not have a chance to win the national title?
I think all 3 of them deserve a chance to be in the title game, and I think that any system you devise could end up with a similar result. But I mean, right now, there's not an alternative. There's not a reasonable way to have a playoff. That's why all this conversation.
Well, how about the old system? How about the old system where at least two or three of the major bowl games played into it?
As the Cardinals rack up yet another sack, Bobby LaFeu and A. Brown combined back at the 21-yard line.
Well, for whatever it's worth, if you'll notice, we're actually evolving back toward the old system. We're much more like the old system now than we were 2 or 3 years ago.
I think that's a good thing, because at least back in that day, you'd say, hey, if Oklahoma can beat so-and-so in the Orange Bowl, then they might have a shot if so-and-so doesn't win big in the Rose Bowl. Now it's just it's a championship game and three consolation games. I think they should call it the Bowl Consolation Series, not the Bowl Championship Series.
Well, maybe they'll change it. Why don't you submit that in an email to management?
Third and 16. Doug Jones cannot get away from Abe Brown. And the Louisville defense continues its domination. Cincinnati held a total of 45 yards of offense. And believe it or not, this was almost as hot an offense as Louisville's coming in. The four-game Cincinnati win streak, they had averaged 460 yards per game, 42 points per game.
And Dave, that was against Memphis, TCU, Southern Mississippi, and South Florida, four good football teams, and they just hammered them.
This, sadly, is probably going to erase in a lot of fans' minds what Cincinnati did to get to this spot. Bowl eligible after seeing Army end its long losing streak against them. But Mark D'Antonio and his seniors regrouped, turned their season around, and it ends in very sad fashion today. The only thing preventing Louisville from having a perfect record, October 14th at the Orange Bowl, second quarter touchdowns, Tiger Jones and Lionel Gates, giving Louisville a 24-7 halftime lead over the Hurricanes, who would fight back in the second half and take a 34-31 lead in the fourth quarter with Devin Anytime Hester scoring on a 78-yard punt return. Louisville answering again, Lionel Gates, 38-34 Cardinals. But Miami would engineer a 56-yard game-winning drive, Frank Gore capping it from a yard out with 49 seconds to go, a 41-38 come-from-behind win for Miami. That is the only thing, that three-point loss, keeping Louisville out of the picture as another unbeaten, and they recovered pretty nicely, 592 yards per game, 54 points per game. Shelton back to work. Nobody's been able to tackle him all day. He went 80 yards on the first play from scrimmage. They bring him down at the one. 54 more yards.
Yeah, let's give it up to the big guys. Number 59, Jason Spitz, was the reason that you saw this thing. Jason Spitz is going to pull right out here, and he performs what we call a log block. See, he hooks the guy. What a great job. Opened up a huge hole. Andre Frazier being hooked to the inside. Good athleticism by the big offensive lineman to get his guy into the end zone. Jason Spitz, number 59.
And if not for Juwan Hall, Shelton has another touchdown.
10 carries, he averages 15.8. Shelton gets it down close, and Colby Smith has himself his second touchdown.
Well, now they're in the end zone.
It was only a matter of time.
I knew they'd get there.
I kind of had a feeling too, Bill.
And you know, what is looking more and more possible is Louisville representing Conference USA in the Liberty Bowl against Boise State, the only team averaging more points per game than the Cardinals. 49 to nothing. What kind of show might that be? That might be first team to 70 wins.
I think that will easily be one of the best two or three bowl games that we'll see during the holiday season.
Folks in Memphis have their fingers crossed for that one. Hey, even in a cold downpour, Louisville fans have a reason to dance, celebrating a 49-0 lead with still half the third quarter to go at Papa John's Cardinal Stadium. Dave Barnett, Bill Curry, David Dorey, Heather Cox. The show continues for the Cardinals. Eric Shelton with a 54-yard dash down to the one, the story on that drive. And the Bearcats on a Mike Daniels return out to the 24 with a flag down. Shelton is now 158 yards on 10 carries. Stephon LaForest, nation's leading passer, 8 of 11, 79 yards and a touchdown. His backup, Brian Brom, 2 out of 4, 55 yards, both the completions for touchdowns. And speaking of Heather, hopefully staying dry down to her.
Indeed I am. One blemish on an otherwise perfect night for Louisville. Three defensive injuries. The big one, Brandon Johnson, to his knee, but he did return back onto the field. We'll finish this game out. His backup, Preston Smith, out with a concussion. And JT Haskins, who we saw earlier in the game, out with an ankle sprain, guys.
And Cincinnati will mark back after a personal foul penalty on their return. And they'll start from their 12-yard line. Murray remains the quarterback, a wide receiver all year till today. Has split time at both positions until this year. Richard Hall, who's had negative yardage all afternoon. Louisville started with an upset with a shutout win over Kentucky. They, unlike Cincinnati, handled Army. And another shutout, too, in their first three games at North Carolina. Again, the only loss, Miami coming from behind to win by three in the Orange Bowl, and they have rolled, averaging 52 per game.
Really the only chinks in their armor. He gave up 600-plus yards to Memphis. Of course, the comeback orchestrated by Brock Berlin in Miami. This defense from Tony Villa gave up some yards.
But all day, the best thing the Cincinnati offense, minus Gino Gadulli, has featured is the quarterback keeper out of the gun. Even so, averaging less than a yard per play, and Louisville better than 10 per play.
There's so many positives to Gino Gadulli playing all the time for 4 years. The one negative is if you lose him, you don't have anybody that can get you out of bad plays. But what Louisville continues to do, we showed you earlier, they're stemming, they're moving their front. The quarterbacks are unable to get them out of the bad plays, and they're running right into the teeth of the defense very often.
So the decisive factor in this game was the top step at Gino's house in Cincinnati. He slipped on it last Saturday night, and embracing his fall, broke a bone in his throwing hand, didn't practice all week, hoping that rest would allow him to play today. He came out through some warm-up passes. Hall has the first down, and the pain was too great. The decision was made to go with Colin Carey, got his first career start, and was replaced late in the first half by Murray.
Well, Bill, and I might argue that Louisville does a terrific job getting their second-string quarterback time, not only in practice but in games. And you live by the sword, you die by the sword. Not giving Colin carry a lot of opportunities in game situations and attempts and completions, you run into this situation if you go top heavy on the play by Gino Gadulli.
All, by the way, now finally up to 0 yards for the day on 9 carries. This is Gladauer, who had a fumble late in the first half. Poor Richard Hall lost yardage on his first carry and still has never gotten it back into the positive column. 888 yards, 4 in Conference USA, his ranking coming into today. And with nobody worried at all about the passing game, he has been the marked man in the Cincinnati
offense.
That's
right. And it's not funny, but I can't help laughing the way you said that. He's been fighting from negative to try to get just to even with 0 yards after the way they started.
On second and 5, the swing pass is complete. Butler Benton knocked out at the 28.
Well, and Bill, as a head coach for you at Georgia Tech and Alabama and Kentucky, you know how tough it is with the limited practice time and the limited snaps and game situations. Oftentimes you have close games. It's tough to get that second stringer in and get him ready to play.
I just think it's really wise. Watching a program like Louisville, Stephon LaFleur is having a chance to set all those records. And let's talk about the Miami game that they lost. Stephon LaFleur had to leave with
Absolutely.
A concussion, and the youngster, Brom, came in and took him right down to a touchdown that put him ahead. It was amazing.
Third and 5. Murray out of trouble and almost out of room before throwing it away.
Well, and LaFleur, I mean, he threw for 3,100 yards last year, and a lot of people said, hey, how can you bring in a true freshman and give him time? Brom's gotten about a third of the snaps this year, and I think Bobby Petrino has done a great job in getting his quarterback situation squared away for the future while still giving LaFleur the snaps and the time to flourish in the system.
And it matters, too, that the guy that he brought in is the number one player in the United States.
Bill, I have to agree with you there. That helps.
Chet Irvin to punt. Wind is stiffened again. He's punting into it, and this is not a bad effort. Montrell Jones. Big return. Only the punter to beat. Irvin misses on a dive. Another touchdown for Jones. 71 yards. The third score today for Montrell. 43 and 13 yard touchdown catches in the first half, and he breaks the punt, and it's 55-0 Louisville.
You guys know the moral to the story, don't you? Never stomp on the Cardinal before the football game.
That's right. That Cardinal's got teeth. You take a look at it, that's not your everyday Cardinal.
Art Carmody continues a perfect season. 8 for 8 today. 3 touchdowns supplied by Montrell Jones. Let's go down to Heather.
Thanks, Dave. I'm joined by Joy LaForce, a very happy Joy, wife of Stephon LaForce, quarterback at Louisville. And Joy, over the last couple of weeks, Stephon's name has been officially linked to the Heisman by the media. How have you guys reacted to that news?
Well, I'm a little biased. I think his name should be on that list, and he definitely deserves, you know, to be mentioned with those quarterbacks since he's a great quarterback.
This is his last home game here at Louisville. How emotional was the pregame ceremony, and what's next for you guys?
It's a little emotional. You've been here 5 years, and it feels like it's going by so fast. But, you know, it's been worth it, and we don't know. We'll just wait and see what comes up for next year.
Stephon has had a record-breaking senior year, yet at times he's had to share the spotlight a little bit with freshman Brian Braun. How has he handled it, and how have you helped him with that?
You know, at first I think it was a little tough, but now he's just accepted it. You know, I told him to stay positive, and whenever he's taken out, he's still cheer on his fellow teammates and keep them going.
A lot of the teammates say that Stephon is the best guy he's ever played with. He does things like bring homemade cookies. I think you have a little something to do with that. What has it been like seeing the reaction that this team has had surrounding him and supporting him?
It's been great. You know, they all love him, and it's really awesome.
Well, congratulations on a great senior year. Stephon has had an incredible career, and we appreciate all your time.
Thank you.
Enjoy this big one. 56-0. Very impressive.
Yes, thank you.
Well, and of course, you know, the guy that has had the accomplishments and the stats that Stephon has put up in his career, very highly recruited out of high school. Well, actually, no. Coming out of Baton Rouge, honored today on Senior Day with his parents, Larry and Susan. Coming out of high school at Baton Rouge, Stephon mass mailed his highlight video to every college he could get an address for. He got one offer from Louisville, and he is the all-time single season passing rating leader. If he can just hold on to what he has with one more regular season game and one bowl game still ahead. You hear so many stories like that. Guys who, coming out of high school, are projected to do nothing, not even make a college team, and they end up some of the biggest stars in the country.
You know, the best thing about him, what his teammates use as a word to describe him invariably, is humble. And there's a Greek derivation of the word humility, and it's the harness that harnessed the power of the horses for the chariot races. That's what humility is, harnessed power. And in an age when so many people are trying to draw attention to themselves, Stephon LaForce would rather give the credit to his teammates, and that's why they love him so much.
Murray looks to turn the corner. He got run down from behind by Abe Brown.
Well, and if you look at Stephon LaForce and you look at the numbers that he's posting, I think he deserves a trip to New York.
Well, he deserves to be mentioned, at least in Louisville football history, along with the namesake of the award for the top quarterback in the country, Johnny U, from 51 to 54 here. 27 touchdown passes. What is that?
That's J.U. intercepting, yes.
No way.
He would like to have played defense in the NFL. He was always trying to block somebody on screens, and we were always trying to keep him from running down the field and getting himself crushed.
Bill, he was the original prime time right there.
Ninth rounder by the Pittsburgh Steelers, discovered playing semi-pro ball by the Baltimore Colts. Hall of Fame inductee 1979, and another sack. George Murray just being pounded as the backup quarterback. Johnny Unitas passed away, of course, a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
He is remembered here, and I know that when he finally became what he eventually was, a star in the NFL, he went back to what he learned here and the opportunities he was given here as a major reason that he finally blossomed in Baltimore.
That's right, and very much like we were just talking about Stephon LaFors, the number one characteristic of John Unitas was his humility. He never tried to draw attention to himself, and it was just such an honor to be on the field with him. Still looks funny to see that 16.
Another block punt. And another recovery for a touchdown. Tiger Jones falls on it this time. Two special teams touchdowns to add to the party for the Cardinals. They have cracked 60.
And we may see some quick kicks on third down from Cincinnati before this game is done.
David, what was it you said you'd do at the half? Work on your punt blocking?
Just go over a few of your T's. Make sure you got your I's dotted and your T's crossed. And evidently, that wasn't a high priority in the locker room.
Chad Rimsey credited with the block. Tiger Jones, the recovery for the touchdown. And now, 9 for 9 on his PATs. Art Carmody, 64 for 64 on the season. 63-0 Cardinals.
I mean, this punt team, this has been just an adventure for Cincinnati. I mean, it's really, they ought to put a 10 over this punt team because it has been a circus today. And Louisville has really turned punt situations into about 28 to 35 points.
Wait a minute now, is it 28 or 35? Right, it's both.
It's hard for me. I need an abacus down here to rack up those points.
Well, how about a calculator? Or have you advanced to that point?
I'm a little bit behind. I'm not like those youngsters in tech age, Bill. It's a little too old.
Todd Flannery teeing it up for the Cardinals. Still a minute three to go in the third quarter, and it's 63-0. Nation number two scoring team averaged 47.6 per game. They long ago passed that. And they have 16 more minutes plus to try to continue. Daniels. Cardinals are playing like it's nothing. One more thing to admire about them today. Tonight, 7:45 Eastern on ESPN, number 10, Boise State, maybe looking at a Liberty Bowl matchup with number 8, Louisville. But tonight they have Nevada to get past in Reno. College football Saturday primetime, presented by Crestor, 7:45 Eastern on ESPN.
If Louisville didn't call off the dogs, the folks over at Cumberland might be a little bit nervous about their record.
Think they can make 222?
That just only take about 7 or 8 more punt situations for Cincinnati.
Murray keeps. They are hitting as hard as if it was the first play of the game.
Yeah, they play hard. And now, David, we should explain that you're referring to the Cumberland Georgia Tech game of 1916. 222-0.
That was way before Bill. You weren't on that team, were you, Bill?
I was a freshman. No, John Heisman was the coach at Georgia Tech, and they had a system that he didn't like. He felt about their system much like you do about the BCS, because it was dependent on the number of points scored, and he wanted to show how absurd that was, and that's why he scored all those points against Little Cumberland.
You mean the bowl consolation series?
I mean, really, it was the equivalent of BCS today, a ranking system that was dependent on how many points were scored, and he thought that was ridiculous, and he figured that was something he could do about it. And there's a famous book that's been written on that game. And the title is what one Cumberland player said to the other. You dropped it, you pick it up.
What were they? Was Mouse Davis coaching, an offensive coordinator on that team?
That was before Mouse was born.
The run and shoot?
21 in the first, 21 more in the second, and another 21 in the third quarter for number 8 Louisville. Dealing misery to the Bearcats about every way imaginable. And still 15 minutes to go. Still a hearty few thousand enjoying every minute of this. 63-0 Louisville. We begin the fourth quarter with David Norrie, Bill Curry, and Heather Cox, Dave Barnett. In rain-soaked Papa John's Cardinal Stadium, which had 42,000 packing it almost 3 hours ago. Fourth quarter begins with a carry by Bradley Gladauer, true freshman from Cincinnati. Again, the tone today set by the disrespect shown by the Bearcats stomping on that midfield logo. They've paid for it every minute since.
Early McCray coming on a corner blitz. If you think Louisville's still not serious about this shutout, here he comes. He hits the off-tackle play. That's not a normal play for a corner, but on the blitz, perfect defensive call.
Second down and six. And Butler Benton picks up the first, up to the 46.
Bill, one of the valuable lessons I learned from Terry Donahue out at UCLA, the winningest coach in the history of the Pac-10, is it's never too early to go to a knee.
Really?
That is with a 63-point lead.
Okay. I was say, that's an odd lesson.
Coach Donahue was famous for never running a score up on a team and really erring the other way in terms of just making sure there was never bulletin board material down the line.
Hall on first down, finally with some room, and another first down. This about doubles his total for the day with 12 yards. Yamaha game track. The tone was set early by the Bush League maneuver by the Bearcats. Cardinals didn't turn it into a brawl. They turned it into a blowout. From the very first play, 80 yards by Shelton. Two block punts returned for touchdowns. Three touchdowns per quarter so far by Bobby Petrino's group. They've allowed just now 100 total yards by the Cincinnati offense. And it's Gladauer spinning for another pickup of 12.
Well, we were standing not 10 yards from that scene when the Cincinnati team came out and jumped up and down on the Louisville logo. And the most impressive thing I've seen from Coach Petrino's team today is not the performance, not the 63-0, not the diversity of their offense and defense, but rather the fact that their players absolutely ignored the insult, did not respond at all, not even with words. They just came out and played football the way you're supposed to play.
What may be the most disappointing thing of all is that apparently no one on the Cincinnati team has paid any attention at all to what's happened in the last week and a half, either in the NBA or in college football between Clemson and South Carolina last week. What were they trying to get as a result of that?
Well, and I agree with Bill. We were out there, and we were literally 10 steps away from where this occurred. Bobby Petrino noticed, and he was very, very active in terms of going after the Cincy folks verbally. But I would be, the Louisville players ignored it, Bill, but I wouldn't be surprised if Petrino used that in his pregame speech in the locker room. I'd be shocked.
I think so.
I'd be shocked if he didn't mention it.
Inside the 20, first down carry Hall. Let's go down to Heather Cox.
I'm joined by Harold Grada, the Associate Executive Director of the Liberty Bowl. So the question begs to be asked, at 63-0, are you guys prepared to give out your first invite for the Liberty Bowl?
We are indeed. As a matter of fact, Heather, we're going to do it right now. the Cardinals are going to be the champions of Conference USA, and we're inviting these Cardinals to come to Memphis, come to Beale Street, and bring a bunch of their fans who love coming to Memphis.
Well, I'm sure they will certainly be looking forward to it. But the question now is, who is the opponent, with Utah perhaps getting the BCS bid? A lot of other names are being tossed about.
Absolutely. We're going to get the best matchup that we can. Boise is a team that is on the radar screen. A lot of dominoes can still fall, but we're going to give Bobby Petrino and this Cardinal team, the best matchup that we can, obviously, tonight. In just a little while, we're going to go watch the Broncos play on ESPN, and we'll see how things develop over the next few days.
Louisville, a very high-scoring team, as is Boise State, number one in the nation in scoring. Is that the type of matchup that you want, or what are you looking for?
Oh, absolutely. If we can get that matchup, we believe that we would have the best matchup of the entire bowl season outside of the national championship game. And fans love to see the ball in the air, see points on the scoreboard, and we think we'll have that for them on December 31st in the AutoZone Liberty Bowl.
We would certainly look forward to that matchup as well. Louisville, looking forward to heading down to Memphis.
Looking forward to having them.
Thanks for joining us.
All right, so there's the bid. Not that it was a big secret where this game has gone. Butler betting on the carry, and then, as you just heard, Boise State tonight against Nevada, trying to stay perfect. 10th-ranked Broncos at 7:45 Eastern. That'll be on ESPN. And if it is Boise State, Louisville, 110 points maybe between the two.
Oh, I agree. I agree with the contention that that would be the most exciting game outside of the national championship game, and maybe even more exciting.
BCS standings brought to you by Allstate. Boise State, number 7 at 10-0, and Louisville behind Miami because of that three-point hurricane come from behind win. The Cardinals, 10th in the standings, coming in today. As Cincinnati tries to end this shutout, Hannibal Thomas had a touchdown pass go off his fingertips in the corner of the end zone. He hangs on to this one and gets it inside the 10.
Well, I disagree with both of you. I disagree with both of you. I don't think that the Boise-Louisville game would be a great matchup. I mean, the Liberty Bowl people are not going to be happy to hear this. I think Boise State has a nice team. We saw them play against Hawaii, and they won the game last year over in Hawaii. We actually did the game. But I don't think they can hang with Louisville. I mean, I think Louisville's too good.
Well, I don't know about that.
A big win for the Cardinals.
I'll tell you what, Boise State, I think they can play their offense, with their offense on the field, against any team in the country.
All might have had it ripped away, but they call him down at the 4.
And that matchup would include two head coaches that are just a few steps away from moving up to the big time.
Well, I just said 110 points. It might be 70-40, but there'd be a lot of points.
Well, Louisville is so dominating. Their offense, their defense is decent, and it's good enough. Their offense is just remarkable, and so it's so deep with the running backs and so deep with the receivers, and the offensive line so good, and two quarterbacks that can just cut you to pieces. I haven't seen an offense like this in a long time.
I think this defense for Louisville is going to have some trouble against the Broncos.
Trying to keep the shutout intact here on second down and goal. Ripping back from the 1, Gladauer.
And that's all assuming that Boise State gets the bid, but I would venture to say that Liberty Bowl would love to have that team.
Well, yeah, the gentleman just said that, and I agree. I mean, if it were me, if I were doing the inviting for the Liberty Bowl, I'd love to see the matchup. My opinion as a football guy is that Louisville's a much better team. I think they'd go in as big favorites, and I think they would justify it.
You look at Houston and you look at Memphis and some of the success they've had here over the last month against this Louisville defense. I agree with Dave Barnett that it's going to be about a 58-55 game.
Third and goal at the 1. Bearcats trying to end the shutout, and they get the touchdown. Butler Benton, the freshman from Detroit, with his 4th touchdown of the year. So at least the Bearcats will go home with points. They will have some points.
Yeah, I say this again. If you're Mark D'Antonio, you just want your team to keep fighting. You want them to go out and try to generate something. And the offense showed life that time. Louisville's playing a lot of reserves, getting all the kids in the game, getting the chance to play. But you still want to try to execute.
Kevin Lovell. 5 out of 36 on the year, and adds 1 to make it 63-7 Louisville. 9:02 remaining. See if the Cardinals may have 70 in them today when we come back. Well, the Bearcats finally sustain a drive. They finally get over the 100 total yard mark. They're at 142 now, and they finally get some points, make it 63-7 with 9:02 to go. Here's a stat that a lot of people enjoy pointing out. lies quite often, but I don't know if it has ever lied as much as it has today, and that would be time of possession. Time of possession is 36 minutes, 15 seconds for Cincinnati, and 14:43 for Louisville. I've never seen yeah. that big a spread
but
in time of possession.
But if you're averaging 20 yards a play, you don't yeah. keep the ball long. Yeah. You score too fast.
When you go
it doesn't mean anything in a game like this.
When you go through a team like a hot knife through butter, it's not going to take long.
Have you either ever seen a spread like that, 36 minutes to 14 minutes?
I have, in blowout games when one team's just so vastly dominant, but not very often, and I can't remember who it was or where it was.
Michael Bush. Gain of about 13 on the handoff from Brian Brohm. 8:54 to go.
What's he doing running out of bounds?
No kidding.
Petrino ought to have him with it. Fall down, stay in bounds, keep that clock
moving. It's never too early to fall down. Isn't that what Terry Donahue said?
Terry Donahue would say that. There weren't many games where TD wouldn't have already called off the dogs.
Well, let's be fair to Louisville. They've called off the dogs. You don't see them throwing the football.
No, that's true. That's
very
true.
They're just running. You know, you could even criticize them for blocking that punt. Why rush the punter? Well, the previous punt, Montrell Jones runs it back 63 yards for a touchdown, so you can't play the game for the other team.
No, you're right.
But you can't protect or cover.
And I didn't mean to insinuate that Bobby Petrino was handling the wrong way. In fact, LaFour's only had 8 attempts in this game.
They barely threw the ball
yeah,
at all.
The ball hasn't seen much air when Louisville's had possession.
And West Brom had 6, something like that.
You know, when I made the comment about Boise State and Louisville that their head coaches might be headed to the big time, this is going to be the big time for Louisville headed to the Big East, but I think that Petrino is going to be fielding a lot of offers, not only this offseason, but in the future.
Well, he's already had offers, and you know that.
Bush, another carry, stays in bounds. Believe it or not, these two combined for 83 points, and it was close last meeting, November 28th of 03. Louisville blew a 21-point lead. They had to rally. Stephon LaFour's 54 yards to J.R. Russell with a minute 10 to go. They won it 43-40 to take home the keg of nails. LaFour's 16 of 27 for 211 and 2 touchdowns and a 69-yard touchdown run in that game. 43-40. 1 year ago, these two.
Well, 2 years ago. 2 years ago here on this field, Cincinnati won.
Colby Smith, who has 2 touchdowns already. Colby Smith down to the 6. He ran right through Kedrick Harwell and kept going for 56 yards.
Now, if I'm number 25, Kedrick Harwell here, I think I would at least make an effort. All right, he's run through everybody else. You're number 25. This is, well, I don't know what, I don't know what you call that.
That's a chicken wing.
He didn't even throw the flipper up
Bill,
there.
Bill, but he attempted to throw a little baby chicken wing at it.
I don't know what you call that.
That's called the phantom chicken wing.
It's called find a hole to crawl in. Over on the bench, Kedrick Bush. Never found the corner and driven out. Gain of 1. But they say keep that clock rolling. I knew I liked this officiating crew.
Did they call him inbound?
Yes, they said he's out.
That's great work.
He's down and they kept it going inside 6.5 minutes. Why not?
But somebody somewhere in the country is going to see this score and he's going to write that Petrino tried to run it up.
No, that is not the case tonight. Although you might argue that Shelton and Bush have been in this game for quite some time.
Second and goal at the 5. Tiger Jones went in motion.
Back up.
But the toss to Smith, who angles toward the pylon, and he got in another touchdown. Colby Smith has 3 scores. Montrell Jones has 3 scores. And the Cardinals are an Art Carmody PAT away from 70.
Now, when I talk about depth and strength for the Louisville team, this is their starting fullback. He's lined up at tailback. He's as good a tailback as most teams in the country have at that position, and yet here he is blocking most of the time for all those other dominating backs. He is a terrific football player.
We've got a day that neither of these schools will forget for a long, long time. 70-7.
ESPN2's College Football Saturday is presented by Hitachi, the ultimate television viewing experience, and in part by Nissan, who invites you to shift the way you move through the world.
Time Louisville scored this many points, 1955, October 1st, 72-0 over Wayne State, 70-7 over Cincinnati, a team with 6-4 with four straight wins coming in. Still 6 minutes to go. Daniel blasted on the return. The Cardinals keep hitting like it's nothing to nothing. Reggie Bradshaw with that blow up touchdown or tackle on the special teams for Louisville, and one more look at the last touchdown.
Gary Barnage, a true freshman. McCauley's played so well at this position, but Barnage is the future at this position, and watch him late just getting the cut down low here. That's just great work by the tight end, Bill, out on
it
the perimeter.
Is. Jamie Murphy fighting for his life but just getting driven off the ball and eventually on the ground.
The way quarterback in the second half, George Murray, Richard Hall on the carry. Let's look at this hit again on the kickoff.
Yeah, at about 35 degrees. This isn't fun for
Reggie Bradshaw, number 26, yet another promising tailback, having some fun on the special teams. And that's the fun when you win and you're doing things properly and you're busting it down on kickoffs and making big hits and something that you enjoy and remember the rest of your life. Good game.
If you're the return man, you're checking your fillings.
There's only a way for the Liberty Bowl to somehow rematch Louisville and Miami. That would be a bowl game. Gladauer on the carry.
11, Gladauer's looked impressive here in the second half. I really like the way that he's run between the tackles, and you know, he's shown a stubbornness running the football.
Bill, you've already said if it's Boise State, Louisville, you don't see Boise State hanging with them. What about the other way? What if Louisville were to get a shot against one of the big three, USC, Oklahoma, Auburn? Could they come out of Conference USA and hang with teams like that?
I think if they didn't turn it over, they could, because, and I think they would give up a lot of points, but I just don't think anybody's going to keep this Louisville team from scoring pretty close to their average. They're just too well drilled. They don't make mistakes, and even against a great defense, I think they would be very difficult to stop.
Well, Bill, and that's probably saying that you think that they could play, because I think this Louisville team has done as good a job as any team in the country taking care of the football. LaFours had a pick in the opening game of the season against Kentucky, went 175 attempts before he threw an interception against Houston. He does a terrific job of taking care of the football. Only 11 turnovers for Louisville coming into
the
this football
game. The whole year,
game.
That's right. They're plus nine on the year coming into this game. LaFours did throw one last week, but that was in a big blowout against Houston.
Finally, some room to ramble for Richard Hall, who spent most of today in negative yardage, 12 yards.
Well, I think LaFours belongs on a trip to New York, a 75% completion percentage, efficiency rating of 195 coming into this game. You know, he has played as well, in my mind, as Matt Leinart, as well as Jason Campbell down at Auburn, Jason White at Oklahoma. And he's been a terrific story for Louisville this season. And I know, as being a former quarterback at the college level, those numbers are just out of this world.
That hour at midfield. Back for an update, Matt Weiner in the studio.
Dave, Mike Price's UTEP team looking for its eighth straight win. They've come back from 17 points down at Tulsa. This is Howard Jackson, 10 yards, and the Miners have taken a 4-point lead. Coming up after Louisville finishes up lighting up the scoreboard, Chaz Williams responsible for 36 touchdowns. He's Georgia Southern's quarterback. First round of the 1AA playoffs next.
Meanwhile, we have some real history, we believe, that's been achieved here by the Cardinals, who came in having scored 56 against Memphis, 55 against TCU, and 65 last week at Houston. As Benton gets the corner. This today makes four straight games of at least 55 points, and as far as our researchers can figure, the last time this happened was 1900. 104 years ago, Notre Dame began the season in their first four games by scoring 55, 68, 64, and 58. And that 58 in game four of the 1900 season came against Cincinnati.
Is there a common thread there, guys?
Should I go over it again? Tried
no,
to do
I'm,
it slowly.
I'm just speechless.
I am too, which is rare for you, Bill. But, you know, that last play, I've never seen an opposing back get booed for going out of bounds, but that's what happened to Benton.
Our Seiko storyline, Gino Gadulli, no doubt would have made a difference. I don't know if he would have kept Louisville under 70, but they probably have a lot more than 7 points. Never played because of the broken hand suffered last Saturday night. First play set the tone for Louisville, 80 yards, almost untouched by Shelton, who has 158 on 10 carries, 482 to 182 in total yardage. 200-yard rushers for the Cardinals. Michael Bush, 12 for 106. LaFour's 8 out of 11, just 79 yards, but a touchdown. And Brohm, 2 out of 4, 55 yards, both completions for touchdowns.
So this big score was run up on special teams and in the running game. And actually, in terms of yards gained, Louisville, 75 yards below their average. So not only had they not attempted to run it up, they just played football. And you play football and play this well on special teams and in the running game, you get a big result.
Well, I think Gadulli might have made a bigger impact as a punter tonight as opposed to the quarterback. Probably could have handled the snaps better with that broken hand. I mean, it was unbelievable to watch this punt team for Cincinnati. Gave the team no chance to win.
Cincinnati was bowl eligible before this game, so they will be 6-5 with whistles and flags. And depending on what bowl they go to, there's some thinking they may go to, for instance, the New Orleans Bowl. That is on December 14th. That's not much healing time for Gino Gadulli.
Question mark for Gadulli, I think, whether he's going to play against, you know, in the season finale for the Bearcats. And he didn't get to play here in the finale, and I think he's a question mark for the bowl game.
And they have to take on the mighty Mean Green, alma mater of Dave Barnett.
That would be a rematch of the 2002 New Orleans Bowl, won by North Texas over Cincinnati. Murray to the end zone for Thomas, incomplete. As he got brushed aside by Jonathan Russell, the safety. Well, when these two played basketball last year, 66 points per game for Louisville against Bob Huggins' basketball team, exceeded by the football team today.
Well, maybe Rick Pitino will look up Petrino and talk about offense. How's that for a little word game? You know what, the trouble with that keg of nails, I'd be afraid that some of my linemen would get confused and with the Gatorade bucket if we won the game, and I wouldn't want those dumped on me.
Well, surely that top is nailed down.
You would hope so.
Final 45 seconds. Again going deep. And again incomplete. That time to target, Antoine Giddens. So Louisville will take the final 38 seconds and celebrate a 70-7 victory. Well, I think if it was possible to open that keg of nails, it would have happened by now. They've been wrestling that thing for the whole time out. And That will take its place alongside all the other trophies in the Louisville football offices. Once again.
And I'm going to say once again that this Louisville team had its finest moment, in my opinion, before the game when they ignored the taunting and just kept going through their warm-up paces and got ready to play football.
James Jackson got that carry.
LaForce just dropped the keg of nails.
One more. Can you believe this stat? Can you believe Louisville scored 70 points and threw 15 passes today? 10 of 15 for 134 through the air, and they still put more points on the board than any time since 1955. 70-7, number 8, Louisville takes Conference USA and the bid in the Liberty Bowl. Again, our final, Louisville, 70-7 over Cincinnati. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Bill Curry, David Norrie, and Heather Cox, Dave Barnett, good afternoon from Louisville, Kentucky. Back now to Matt Weiner.
Dave, guys, appreciate it very much. Coming up, Ricky Santos, the freshman for New Hampshire, contender for the Walter Payton Award. 29 touchdowns compared to just 7 interceptions. He and the Wildcats will try to take down Georgia Southern in the first round of the 1AA playoffs. Hi, everyone. Matt Weiner back in our college football studio. Louisville can take the keg of nails. They could take some paper clips and staples, whatever they like, because they basically plundered the Cincinnati defense. 70 points for them, and on their way out of Conference USA, they take the outright title and probably a date in the Liberty Bowl with perhaps Boise State.